Hey Fakers, welcome to season two of Faking It Podcast. It's been a nice summer and taking a little break was fun, but I'm so happy to be back. On this episode, I talked to Kate Conway, who starred in the hit web series Out With Dad. We're going to talk about being an actor, inspiration, jealousy, and how she's a huge jerk. Here we go. Welcome to the podcast, Kate.
Hi.
How you doing?
I'm all right. How are you?
Good. Welcome in Miss Kate Conway to the old cast. How's it going? What's new with you?
You know, just living the dream.
Yeah? What's the dream for you?
Being an actor.
Ooh.
being an actor. Writing, producing,
mm-hmm.
You know, that kind of thing. Just being in stuff.
Good. And what are you, you and I met on the set of Out With Dad.
We did.
And we talked to a couple people from Out With Dad here. We've spoken to Jason Lediver.
Mm-hmm.
Lediver.
That's his hairdresser name.
Yeah, that's the... Yeah, that's true. Lever. And we've spoken to the composer, Adrian Ellis, and mm-hmm. Lindsay.
Mm-hmm.
So you are Rose, yes. In the series.
I'm the star.
You're the star, as you will always remind everyone.
Number one on the call sheet.
Number one on the call sheet.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So how was that sort of for you? That was one of the, like, first web series to poke its head out of web series culture, I guess, in Toronto. And so we heard Lindsay's kind of experience with it, but yours would have been a little different considering you were the main character. So what was that like for you?
It's been an amazing experience and something I consider myself very blessed to have happened to me. It started out, I just graduated theater school, coincidentally enough, same one that Lindsay did, theater and drama studies at U of T. And I just graduated and I was trying to put together a demo reel, and there was a post on Mandy looking for an actor who was over the age of 18 who could play young in this series about a girl coming out of the closet. So went to the audition. Jason was at the audition. Our friends Rebecca and Eric were there too and did the audition for them and then left, and then got a call from Jason being like, we're just, you know, we want to see if you're a cool person. Like, it was, and then he was like, you don't even have the part. We would love to get together for coffee. So I got together, get together for coffee with him and Eric Taylor. And they told me that I had the part, and that was great. And they brought me back in to read with the other characters. So I got to read with all the Vanessas who auditioned and got callbacks. Lindsay was one of them. And then also all of the dads, and Will Conlon was one of them. So that was cool. So from day one, it was like, it was just a super exciting thing. I was going to be the lead in this show that I had a lot of faith in. And then as time went by, we just sort of like all super bonded, like we hyper bonded. Jason has become one of my best friends. He will admit that at first he thought that I didn't like him. I didn't like the cast and I just went off and kept doing my own thing. But we went to New York together that first year that the Indie Series Awards invited us to come, and we had a great time. So just as time has gone on, and that time's been about 5 years, we've slowly become just like super close, super supportive of each other's work, and then we all just want to be involved in each other's work. So I've been working with Jason on a number of other projects, as well as just kind of whenever he needs me, he just messages me and is like, we need to do this for Out With Dad. We need to do a video diary, or we need to do a blog post or something like that. So he just contacts me and then I do it. And we have a lot of fun, and we continue to have all these fans that love us and support us, and it's just been a wild ride.
Having, like, graduated and then gone right into that audition, was that sort of your first big thing that happened?
Or? Pretty much, and really wasn't at the time, wasn't supposed to be a big thing, because
right.
It was just me finding an audition on Mandy, which is all just indie projects, student films, that kind of thing, and at the time, it was an indie project, but I sort of, and so did Jason, foresaw the potential of what it could become. There really wasn't anything like it on TV, of course.
Mm-hmm.
And then the web, there was some things sort of sprouting out, Anyone But Me, that kind of thing. But we really believed that this show was going to be something important. And I got really excited because I had been gifted with the lead role, which, of course, the one main thing for me was, like, I need to do this role justice because I don't identify. I'm breaking everything. <That's fine. laughs> I don't identify as LGBT. I'm an ally, but I'm not part of the community. But I wanted to do the role justice. I wanted people to believe it and be inspired by it. And I think we've done that.
Yeah, absolutely. Seeing the response, I think that's absolutely true.
I don't know.
Did you think of it as like inspiring because you saw like a lot of the script really quickly, or was it because you were thinking, I want to do this justice because it's like a new medium that's very rarely or like hasn't really been?
More so the latter, but definitely some of the former. Like Jason's scripts were good. He was sort of a first-time writer to this kind of I guess content, and so he was, it was weird because he was sort of finding himself as a writer as the character herself was figuring herself out. And it was great because the character really didn't understand what was going on inside of her, which was easy for me because I was also trying to figure out, you know, how somebody would navigate these waters. But it was more so that, like, yes, there wasn't a representation of this anywhere in mainstream media. And I knew just from, you know, life, having common sense, that there are people out there that, like, especially the LGBT community who have no choice but to keep it silent. And to keep, like, because there are people who risk death they live. To
be who they are.
Exactly. So this character was going to be someone who at least at the very bare minimum was going to make them feel less alone.
Yeah, right. Yeah. And Rose, the character, is coming from, I guess, like more of a privileged situation. But it in that way, it's that people can at least go on a YouTube channel and like just get away and connect with somebody.
Exactly. Yeah. And the response is, yeah, we've had people from all over the world. What's kind of breaks your heart a little bit is when they're like, I wish I had a dad like Nathan. I wish my mom would get it. And it's, you just kind of want to go to them and go sit their parents down and be like, okay, come on, just dial it back a bit.
You gotta just, you know, get over yourself. But there was like parts of the story that also did connect with the rougher sort of, I guess, areas where people have to deal with coming out to their parents in like a religious setting, which was Lindsay's character. Mm-hmm. So did you have anything to do with like the writing or how the story kind of took place or form after the first season, besides of course playing the role? But you wore many hats as well too.
I did. I don't know if I say that I necessarily steered it in any kind of direction. Jason does have a lot of friends and writers and, what are you doing?
I'm breaking everything now.
Yeah,
it's my
turn.
You're
breaking everything.
Fuck.
Our first F-bomb. I love it.
There'll be more.
Yes. Fuckity fuck, fuck, fuck face.
There you go. You win.
But he's had people that have been able to probably more correctly to help him tell the story. Our friend, we have a good friend named Nadine Bell, who got involved in the series, season 2 or 3, can't remember when it was, who's her own experiences are helpful. And just some other people that have just been working on it. I'm a sounding board for Jason. Like the writing's not done unless I've looked at it, essentially. Mm-hmm. But 99.9% of the time, I'm like, great, I read it. It's perfect. Yeah. Let's do it. So I did write one scene that was supposed to be a scene between me and Kenny that just never got made because of it just didn't work out. And then I did write some of the video diaries. Those ones was just a great sort of experimentation for Jason and me, for him for filmmaking and then for me for writing. So
great. That's awesome. And from that, you've participated in other web series. So the community sort of engulfed you and pulled you in that way.
It engulfed me.
Engulfed
in flames.
In flames. It's just been crazy. So what other podcasts, what other web series have you been involved with?
I wrote a bit and was in The Gate, which only had one season, unfortunately, but was a pretty smart comedy about the gates of heaven. And then what else have I done? don't even know. I worked with my friend Izzad. He needed to put some web content together for, he has this great character called Layla. The project's called Love with Layla, and he was doing shows, one man, or if you want to argue about it, one woman, because he would dress as a woman from Iran with a beard and a hijab and sort of, you know, break all of the rules, mm-hmm. gender bending craziness. And it was a character that I thought was really great. So I helped him, and Jason helped with that, produce some content for that. And then recently I've helped with an all female written and produced web series called That's Why I Like Her. And I'm working on my own shiz.
And what's your own shiz?
My own shiz is called, the web series is called Hashtag Kate Conway is a Jerk.
And how did that come about?
I can see it in your eyes.
Kate, like, Conway.
Let's get to this one now so she can talk about it. So how it started is really, I love the idea, because it starts out of the fact that my best friend named Tamara Zradkovic, which I'm butchering the name, it's Macedonian, I've known her since theater school, and she's my biggest fan, and... pretty
I've
much
definitely met her. I
she's
know
she's my manager and yeah. my agent and my entourage. She when Out With Dad was doing very well, we were winning a lot of awards, she would introduce me at all of her lawyer parties, because she's a lawyer, as award-winning actress Kate Conway. And I would tell her to stop doing that.
Because award-winning means like an Emmy or
yeah,
an Oscar.
Yeah, they're like, oh, you won a Golden Globe?
Yeah, that's what it means.
Is Leonardo DiCaprio as charming as I think? It's like, stop.
It's not the same thing.
I won an award that you haven't heard of. I was happy to get it, but you don't know what it
you
is.
You definitely don't know it.
So I would beg her to stop doing that, and she wouldn't. So we sort of created a little inside joke where it was like, she would pass me a jar of something and be like, hey, can you open this for me? And I would say, well, Tam is the 2012 and 2014 winner of the series awards for best actress in a drama series. I think I can open that can of whatever for you. And it was just something that I did over and over again. And at the time, Jason was bugging me. He was like, let's make some comedy. I had just made it into the Second City Toronto Conservatory classes, which was really exciting. So he was like, let's make comedy. And we decided to make a short film where I essentially say that upon any request anyone throws
for
at
any
me.
Help, yeah.
And then as we were editing, Jason said, you know, I'm putting episode one on this, because he's such a web series person.
Yeah.
I kind of knew it was coming, but then I was like,
he's going to make this an episodic, that bastard.
So we decided to...
he's like that web series wizard or something.
Web series wizard?
Yeah, just like sits in the corner and decides everyone's fate.
You think you're making a movie? No!
You're making a web series.
Sign yourself up. You're never going to see your family again.
That's awesome. So that's like season two that you're working on soon?
Well, yes. So we wrapped season one last year. Basically what we need to do is we need to do some crowdsourcing, because I cannot afford to feed people on set.
Mm-hmm.
So look out in the next few weeks, hopefully, that there's a video, because we do need some sort of financial backing to it. It doesn't have to be all that much. And then after September, because there's going to be some more Out With Dad filming that needs to happen, and that's priority number one.
Mm-hmm.
So September and the beginning of October will be devoted to that, and then hopefully we'll get back into filming for end of October for Kate Conway's a Jerk season two. And we usually release them like pretty soon after we film whatever episode we just did, so
because they're kind of a quick, like they're not a long
I try segment. To if I can pare them down production wise like I would love to make them, you know, $1 million budgets and take 6 months
nice.
To make them. Wouldn't we all?
Yes.
Love that.
We really would. So. That's cool. So what about like your history in comedy? Is that something that you were really into in theater school, or is it something that came up because you're like, oh, Second City, I'm gonna just, you know, be in the conservatory because that's easy.
I grew up watching comedy, and my brothers were both did stand up, and I did stand up in high school. We were all big fans of Saturday Night Live and stuff like that, and sort of my icon became Tina Fey. So I thought that was going to be my focus. And then I did stand up in the real world and had my heart broken very quickly.
Ooh, was it just like you kind of what, crashed and burned? Or?
Well, yeah, you're just not funny. Nobody laughs. And you're like, well, I guess I'm done with this. So
did you completely move on from it?
I just never did it again. Never got up on a stage and tried stand-up again.
One time?
I did it one downtown one time. But the funny thing was, it was at like some sort of like Jewish...
there's your problem.
You would think like a room full of Jews. Yeah. They're all about the comedy. I bombed, as they say, and then just never did it again. And focused more on just getting film and television roles, whatever those roles were. Mm-hmm. And, weirdly, I had been wanting to take some sort of acting classes, because everyone's like, you need to beef up your resume. You need to go do some sort of acting classes. And I had asked a couple people about the Second City thing, and there were some mixed reviews. Some people loved it. Some people didn't find it as beneficial as others. And I was going to start by doing the Level A courses, which anybody can sign up for. If you've got a credit card that works, you can do the Level A courses. And somebody was like, well, no, you already have a theater degree. You shouldn't start from the bottom. You'd be way better than everybody else right out the gate. So I kind of sat on it for a while. And the story of me getting into Second City, I think is a great story. And my friend Heather thinks it's a great story. But I don't think anybody else thinks it's a great story.
Should tell it to us now.
I'm telling it to you now. So I'm a huge fan of Star Trek The Next Generation.
Okay.
There's an episode called Tapestry, where Captain Picard, his synthetic heart explodes, and he thinks he's dead.
Okay.
And
he thinks he's dead? Like he sees his synthetic...
Exactly.
Okay.
Scientifically speaking, yes. he goes into this like white world and he thinks that he's dead, and he sees Q, which is if you know the show, Q is kind of just a dickhead omnipotent being.
That dickhead Q.
Yeah, and Picard's like, great, you're God. This is going to be terrible and a terrible afterlife. But Q essentially lets him go back in time to when he got stabbed with the Nausicaans and he gets his heart removed and has to get a fake heart. So Q gives him an opportunity to change his past to something that he thinks that he regrets, but it ends up turning him into a scared, pathetic little science officer, and it changes
his captain.
Exactly. He loses his ability to lead and go on all these crazy adventures. So there's one monologue where Q is just like telling him, he's like, because of you decided not to do this, nobody ever noticed you. You remained a boring, uninteresting person that nobody wanted to see what you could do. And I kind of watched the episode when I was under the influence of alcoholic beverages. And I was watching the show and I was just like, no one ever noticed him. Well, someone's gonna notice me. And I basically sent in my application for the conservatory that moment.
Hopefully also while drunk?
Yeah.
Oh, great.
I'm surprised. There's not...
Probably why you got in.
There's not that many...
You're like, this girl's hilarious.
She's making all these unnecessary Star Trek references.
She's just so weird. We gotta get her in here.
So I submitted to it and went to the audition and managed to get into it, which is a feat because a lot of people actually do, you know, they've
like
done
the
ADE.
All the courses, yeah.
Yeah, and because of my theater degree, they had accepted my application, then I auditioned and got in, and I was in there, very soon realized that I was trying to keep my head above water, because the people that I was in these classes with were not only had they done all of the courses, they were all really good at improv and writing and stuff. So I immediately was starting wondering, I'm like, who picked me? Like, what idiot made the mistake of coming into work drunk and picking me and putting me into this program? But it was very, very beneficial, and it sort of re-inspired in me that, like, I am capable of comedy. I love comedy. So why not just try to do it? Just like with the web series philosophy in general. If you love it and you want to make it, just go make it.
Yeah, exactly. So, you never know if you don't go for it.
Exactly.
So that's cool. How long of a program is that?
Well, the conservatory is a year long. So you spend the first few months doing just improv, which is the most terrifying thing in the world to me. Anxiety inducing.
Stressful, yeah.
Oh, God, it was horrible. I'm having flashbacks now to some of my terrible scenes. And then the second part, you get to work on some former sketches that the Second City main stage like produced.
And stuff, right?
Yeah, we did. We did a really fun one that we got to watch the video of that Steve Carell actually did years and years ago back in Chicago. And then the final part of it is you get to write and be in a big show, a big main stage show. And ours was, it was called Till Death Do Us Party, and it was so good. It was the, again, I could not sing the praises of the people that I was in class with because they're just all such really smart, creative, funny people.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's awesome. So when you get into like talking about out with dad and that you don't identify as somebody who's LGBT and the ideas of representation, and maybe as you get further into like filmmaking and doing your own kind of, you know, series and whatnot, do you look at the ideas of representation and think about like what it's like to play somebody who doesn't actually identify as somebody who's LGBT? Or do you kind of look at things and think that you're going to open yourself up to that community and do research? Or like, how do you prepare for something like that?
The cat really wants to get your water and you're allergic.
All up in my water. Get out of your kit.
To be perfectly honest, I don't think I probably think about representation all that often. Generally, I think I do what a lot of writers probably do, which is they just put themselves in the place of whatever main protagonist. They put a lot of their own qualities and stuff like that. I think from being in Out With Dad, it has opened my eyes to these other avenues. And frankly, like, we just came back from pitching another show idea in Montreal about the disabled community, which is something that I had never thought of before. So I'm all for it. I'm just not the type of person I'm fascinated by other cultures and other things, but I'd be wary of saying, oh, I'm going to be the one to tackle that, because I'd be a little nervous about doing it wrong. But if I was given the task, and somebody said, no, just go do some research, go make sure you're not messing this up, then I'd love to explore other avenues. And one of the things that people often say, because I seem to, people seem to want me to keep playing LGBT characters.
Mm-hmm.
And people are like, oh, are you worried to get typecast? I'd be like, absolutely not. Like, there's a million different types of stories that come out of these communities.
Yeah, you can't really, like, it's not the same thing as being, like, a ditzy blonde.
Exactly.
It's not, because it's just, like, being LGBT is, like, there's a huge difference.
Yeah.
Like, of different array of things that you can be.
Mm-hmm. And one of the things we're exploring with Out With Dad in the next set of episodes is this whole idea of gender identity. It goes even further beyond somebody who identifies as trans. Like, it's sort of how you just sort of identify yourself, and that idea of putting a label on yourself mostly to just explain it, but then at the same time kind of tossing it aside and being like, I'm not about labels. I'm just about living my life and being with the people that I love and that kind of thing. So yeah, I'm definitely open to all subject matters. But mostly for me, I stick to, when I'm writing something, I'm usually putting myself as I am, as the character I'm thinking of.
Right, yeah. So with the Just for Laughs, you just pitched an idea. What's the show idea, and what was that like? That seems like a pretty intense thing, if you want to explain like what the whole program was and everything.
Sure. The thing that we submitted to was called Stand Up and Pitch, and I'd heard about it before, but I didn't have any solid ideas of my own that I thought this is gonna just win over a bunch of people. But Jason came to me a little while ago telling me that, you know, he's been going around to different avenues and trying to pitch other ideas that he's had, and he's been told he needs to have more comedy ideas. So when he said that to me, I was like, well, wait, there was one that we pitched a while back for the IPF, the Independent Production Fund, that we submitted. It just never got made. It's called But How Do You Have Sex? ? And it's based on two people that we actually know, our friends Russell Winkler, who you just did the season finale recording with, and his best friend Nadine Bell. Russell's in a wheelchair or a wheelchair user,
yes,
which is something I learned recently that I have to say. And then Nadine Bell, who identifies as a lesbian, and what it's like for them to date around Toronto. So we submitted it for IPF, didn't get in. Jason kind of shelved it. And then when he was telling me about needing comedy, I was like, well, we have a show that's a comedy. And he was like, oh, okay. So then Jonathan Robbins, our friend, he's the dad in It With Dad, and he also is on the IAWTV like board group or whatever, was like, you should submit to the Just for Laughs stand-up and pitch. So we did, got in, became a finalist, which meant that we were invited to come to the Just for Laughs thing, which was in Montreal from the 27th of July to the 31st. And basically, we had to go up against four other teams who were pitching web series ideas, and there were going to be four panelists. Now, I think I'm getting this wrong, but I think I'm close. One of them was from Shaftesbury and or Smoke Bomb. One of them was from CBC. One of them was from HBO. And one of them was from Funny or Die. And they were all sort
and
of like...
you guys.
And then us.
us Whoa, little, that's major. Us I didn't babies. Know that it was... I didn't know that it was open to actual like production... I thought it was just like sort of like independent people.
No. It was, well, these people work, they work in some form or another, with those places, but they're sort of like head of digital, for lack of better. Cause I can't remember. I apologize to those lovely folks, but, that was sort of where they came from. And we were supposed to stand up in front of them and then an audience. There was going to be an audience there. It was one of the most nerve-wracking things. Cause there was one that went before us that was for TV. Ours was for the web, and we watched all the TV pitches, which was really fun. But at the same time, it was like 10 in the morning and ours didn't start till noon. And it was just, every moment was agony for both me and Jason, I think. But we got up there, we did it, and we watched the other ones, which were really great. And there was a winner. They did pick a winner. This really great show that I hope gets made called How to Buy a Baby. I know.
Oh.
Oh, yes.
Sounds like a quaint family program.
The lady who makes it was so cute and so nice. The show is about like what it's like to not be able to have your own kids,
to like adopt or to go find a place to get a baby,
all the different avenues. But she had this really good pitch that deserved to win, and so she won. But
that's
the
great.
Rest of them were all really, really good. And we had some people coming up to us afterwards telling us that our idea was really good. Here's my card, let's keep in touch.
Great, yeah.
Which is essentially what you want.
Networking, even if you don't win it.
Exactly.
Still got some, you know, connections.
Apparently a couple of the shows last year that didn't win have gotten made. So
that's great.
So that it's something that I'm explaining to members of my family. They're like, you didn't win? I was like, well, technically
I didn't. But I kind of did.
Yes.
Got to meet a lot of cool people.
Exactly. And we got industry passes and we got to go
to... that is worth it in itself. Oh. Did you see a lot of stand-up there?
No.
Different shows that they had?
Well, we could have, except that like the industry pass was only good for... the panels and like sort of the talks that they were doing about the industry. We got to see Variety's 10 to Watch, which included Roy Wood Jr. and I can't remember something Chang. They're both on The Daily Show. And then there's one, our cinematographer that was at Danielle, I think she's amazing. She was losing her mind that we got to see.
Oh, her name was Carmen Esposito.
There we go. We got to see her. We got to meet her.
She's fantastic.
And then so we saw that. We got to go to a live recording of Harmontown, which is Dan Harmon's podcast.
How was that?
So good.
That's
and
great.
So crazy. He invites people up on stage, but the way he does it is he asks, the first question is, who's having a terrible time right now? And he invited up this guy who admitted that his wife had died because of some sort of condition. She was pregnant. And it was some sort of condition where, I can't remember the name of it, I think it starts with an E, and she had passed away in March. And so Harmon was talking to him, and he was like, so what else are you seeing here at the festival? And he's like, just this. The guy drove from Ottawa just to come to Harmontown. But then he came up, and then this other girl who was this big World of Warcraft nerd, she was having a great time. That was her reason for getting up on stage. So we saw that, and I've never seen any interviews with Dan Harmon before, but I'm a fan of Community, so he's just so weird and so ridiculous.
Yeah, a bit of an odd duck.
Yeah. So we saw that, and then the Master of None from Netflix did a panel. Aziz Ansari and Alan Yang were there with some of the cast, and that was really cool. And then we saw the premiere of Sausage Party with his face?
Oh, what's his?
You know.
Yeah, I know.
Big boisterous laugh.
Yeah. Oh, he's the pot smoker from Vancouver.
Everyone knows who we're talking about right now. But
yeah,
he was there.
Sausage guy.
Yeah. He was there, and Kristen Wiig was there, and some other writers from the movie. And I really enjoyed enjoyed the movie. So we got to see that. And then, of course, we got to just go to parties. Like, we got to go to...
Like, the Netflix party. I was just following y'all's fucking Instagram and all that.
Much poutine and Montreal
there's a lot of photos of poutine.
Yeah.
A lot.
I know. It's like, you think one would be enough, but then there is a reason
never
to post
it is.
A second.
Never is. Never is.
So...
More poutine.
But yeah, so it was just one of those, like, once-in-a-lifetime experiences that we had so much fun. And every now and again, like, it's the Outwood Dad family, as I like to call it, gets to go on these trips and just have a ridiculous amount of fun.
Yeah.
And every so often, I kind of get a little sad. I'm like, Outwood Dad is eventually going to end, and mm-hmm. we're all going to go our separate ways, and it's going to be over. And yet it keeps happening. Like, we just...
it recycle. I think it's just because it's a good thing. You got to keep a good thing going. And it's not just on one thing. It's like when someone else has a project, like you said, you can, mm-hmm. you can depend on the fact that, like, I need writing help here, or I need mm-hmm. like someone to come for this. And
exactly.
they do. Like, that's that.
It's wonderful.
Yeah. That's really nice to have creators like that and people you connect with and that aren't total assholes.
That's helpful.
Yeah. I mean, it seemed like a lot of, like, non-assholes collected into a room all at once.
Yeah. I mean, like, we do run into our fair share of assholes within the entertainment community.
Well, of course.
It's inevitable, mm-hmm. but we've managed to... We've managed to
Breaking dishes.
Break it. That's a Rihanna song that I really like.
I enjoy that you got that reference. You should have been like, up in here.
I don't. You actually sounded British when you said that. You were like,
oh,
up in here.
That's how I speak gangsterness.
Go Brexit or go home.
No, exactly. We don't like that. Yeah, cool. Yeah. So what else is kind of coming up for you? Is there any other things that you're working on? Or actually, no, sorry, scratch that. I want to rewind. So going up to actually pitch, was that sort of like you've ever done anything like that before?
No, I would say the closest thing that it's ever been like was stand up.
Yeah, I was
going to
say it sounded like that.
So, yeah, so me and Jason like wrote this, it had to be 5 minutes. It couldn't be any more. Mm-hmm. So we like wrote this thing together and, cause it's just for laughs. So you try to punch it up, you try to make it funny. So I wrote a couple of jokes for it and, we went up and did it. And at least to me, people may disagree because it's not true or because they're just trying to be nice, but it felt like none of the jokes landed.
Jesus. And so that's just sometimes your blood is pumping and you can't actually hear.
True.
I kind of feel like that's what it is sometimes because you might leave stage and be like, that was fucking terrible.
Oh, that's exactly
how it
felt.
No, what are you talking about? Everyone like reacted to it. You're like, no, they didn't. And then you can see maybe if hopefully if there's some video footage back, like, oh yeah, it didn't go that bad.
I don't even know if I want to watch the video footage. Because
it's
just, yeah, like it brought back that sort of sting of getting up on the stage and trying to tell jokes and trying to make people laugh.
Right, and then just wondering, did I just go deaf, or am I? No, I can hear. Yeah, it's just no one's laughing. That's great. Awesome.
Yeah. So it was incredibly nerve-wracking. And then we were also, we didn't use any media.
Was that popular for people to do when they pitched? They had like a whole thing?
Pretty much everybody showed a sizzle reel or some capacity of what they had already done. And we had a trailer from the IPF that we could have shown, but we just decided against it because we figured it would be redundant. The panel had already looked through our package. They had seen our materials. So we were trying to be as brief and concise as humanly possible. And it turns out that we could have probably shown something. Mm. And then one of the things, I guess I'll say this as sort of like a lesson for anybody who's going to be pitching. One of the guys pointed out, because Jason had brought it up, that like we didn't show anything because we thought it would be redundant because we knew that everybody on the panel had watched it. One of the panel members said, well, for the future, you're always going to want to assume that they haven't seen your materials, which was technically incorrect because part of the rules of it was like, no, approach it as if the panel has seen everything.
Oh, okay.
Make it concise and brief.
Like, have you read your rules lately?
The panel member was just, I think, trying to get across to us a point for an actual pitch meeting where it would be behind closed doors.
Oh, for sure. I mean, you guys wouldn't have held back then if you had like a 45 minutes mm-hmm. of unbridled, like, just, of course,
but
stuff.
For me as an actor and a performer, my approach to it was more like, no, we have to sell comedy. We have to get up there and be funny people and convince them that we could make a funny show.
Right.
So I don't know if that came across.
It probably did, but I mean, you never know. Like, when you collect panelists together, I guess they all came from different backgrounds and whatnot. Mm-hmm. So you don't ever know what kind of thing is going to happen that way. Like,
for sure.
You could get anybody there.
Yeah. Like, I know there was somebody there from, I think there was somebody there from HBO, again, in their digital field, sitting next to somebody from Funny or Die. Like, those are two very different forms of media. Mm-hmm. Everything that they had to say was incredibly helpful and educating and gave us ideas for if we had another opportunity, we were like, oh, we would approach it completely differently. But the actual experience itself to me was like numb flashbacks to stand up.
Helicopter flying over. Oh no, that's just me shitting myself.
When I shit, it sounds like little darts coming out of
me.
That's
how it is.
Yep.
Yeah, you just gotta run. So would you pitch again?
Oh yeah, for sure.
Of course I'd go up there and torture myself. Why not?
I'm trying to take this experience and use it as more of a motivation to push myself, because I do have people being like, you must have ideas. You must have ideas for shows. And for the longest time, I kind of half did, but they weren't really formulated. They weren't put together.
Like pieces of things. Like, this scene would be interesting. Yeah. Or if somebody said this, it'd be hilarious.
Exactly.
That's how my brain works too. Like 17 million pieces of things, but nothing together.
Just constant randomness in your head.
Exactly.
Dogs wearing tuxedos. I love it.
Yeah. Where could it fit it? Okay. Idea's done.
No, that's the idea. It's over.
No show, no more.
Yeah. So I did walk away from it kind of trying to force myself to figure out what my concentrated ideas would be. Mm. And I'm saying I've got a couple of ideas that I've now thought of, and I would like to, I'm going to try to push myself to
explore
and maybe start trying to just pitch them within the community that I already get to use and potentially submit to things like Stand Up and Pitch Again. Cause I'd love to go back to that. That was,
yeah, that
so
sounds
fun.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
So do you find yourself, well, like, if we can go back to the Q moment that you kind of like inspired
we
you to go,
we can always go back to the Q moment. That's the moment everyone should watch.
What's the name of the episode again?
It's called Tapestry.
Tapestry.
It's on
Let's just
Netflix.
Go back to Tapestry for a moment.
Yeah.
Okay. So do you find, like, with performing, because that moment was sort of like, what the fuck are you waiting for? Like, get your shit together and do it. Because if you don't, you never will know. Does that sort of come into play a lot for you, like as a performer and actor and a producer and all of the things that you do?
I would say yes. One of the things that a lot of creative people, whether they're actors or musicians or whatever, we have our own sort of little struggles that we deal with. We're kind of often fighting with ourselves a lot of the time. For me specifically, I would say that motivation can be really hard. Not to be dramatic, but things like depression, anxiety, those sort of things creep into my life way more often than I want them to. Mm-hmm. So I try to use little motivational things, whether it is sort of being like watching an episode of something and trying to have it kick me in the ass and get up and do it. Another thing is like, I will force myself to say something out loud to people. And once you've said it, you're kind of accountable now. You're kind of like, if I look at you and say, oh, we're going to make a season two of Kate Conway's a Jerk. Well, I better fucking
do it.
You feel
now it's not just your inner like voice, like torturing yourself. It's like out there.
Yeah, exactly. So, that sort of battle is something that, I personally have struggled with. And I know other people, especially creative people, just are their biggest enemy seems to be themselves. Mm-hmm. So if you can just wake up every day and recognize that and try to find little ways to push yourself to do it, you will do it. It will get done. Mm-hmm. So
what would you, like, if you ever get into a funk where maybe you're lacking inspiration or maybe, you know, you have like a shit ton of stuff to do, but like, obviously you've been there before where you're like lacking the inspiration to complete or to like get through something. Is there anything that you do that like actually helps you with that?
Well, in terms of completing stuff, I'm good at completing stuff. Once the project is started, it will be finished.
Okay.
More so the inspiration thing, where I will actually have to force myself to sit down and say, no, this is going to be an hour where I just write a sketch.
Okay, so like sort of discipline and schedule sort of helps you.
Yeah, I'm not much of a self-starter, but if somebody tells me to know between the hours of 1 and 3, we're going to be doing this, I will always show up. I will never not show up. So that's a trick that I've recognized within myself. Like, no, I'm not going to just take a day off and get something done. Just whatever. It's no. Someone's going to be like, this is the time that you will do it. It will be done by this point. There's a deadline. And then once I do sit down and force myself to do it, I get really into it and I'm suddenly hypercritical of everything I just did. It's like, wait, that doesn't make sense. We got to fix this. This is stupid. So yeah, I guess that's my trick.
So do you work full-time work that's like a Joe job to like fund sort of your artistry?
Yes, that's my primary source of income. I do a lot of different jobs. I'm a server at a sports bar. Which is interesting. I work as...
I like that.
It's interesting. Oh, it's very interesting. It has given me lots of ideas creatively, as well as my other Joe job where I'm a hotel concierge, or Western geisha, as Michael Scott says on The Office, which is, I think, is hilarious.
Yeah.
That's really accurate. That's what Tamara calls me now.
She's my award-winning...
This is my award-winning Western geisha. So I do that. I've helped out in my uncle's office as like as to make extra money. Mm-hmm. Whatever I can do.
Right. And that's something that's like, do you in between that, say for example, I think a lot of things that artists will go through to like, I guess, negotiate with themselves to be like, well, I'm not going to get this job, like maybe purposely not go into something that's like a 9-to-5, very like rigid and whatever. Maybe it's just not their speed. Some people just give in and go to do that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. But for you, do you have sort of like, do you find that you have to really structure what you're doing? Like if you have a day off, are you like, okay, I need to make sure or try to get an audition on that day? Or do I need to like, do you structure and schedule things like that?
I try to. One of the things that's kind of worked out, I got the job in the restaurant recently. And it's been very helpful in terms of that I mostly am working nights now. So I'm able to go to more auditions without having to turn my whole life upside down in order to get to them. I would say that it is all about organization because usually my Joe jobs will take up a whole day of something and then I'll have like one day in the week. So today was my day off. And so I needed
I've taken it.
You have robbed me.
I've robbed you of your
of
time.
All fun today. Thanks, Liz.
You're welcome.
I'm not going to even
going
to go.
Pastime.
I'm not even going to go see Ghostbusters for a second time anymore because I'm just
so
distraught.
You're not going to do that. It's not fun.
I try to do that, and if I do have a script to write or read or memorize, like that's when I would do it as well because I can't do it at my other jobs. So yeah, you do learn how to balance. It was something that I was also was taught in theater school, and my theater school was really great for it. The theater school I went to, it was a university, so you had university classes during the day, and then you had to be at a theater every night, either doing crew or you were in the shows or something like that. And then, of course, it's university, so I had a part-time job. I worked at Wendy's. I worked at an ice rink selling coffee and french fries. And I look back at that time, and I was busier that time, but I was able to structure my time properly. And there were people that wanted to be in that theater program who weren't really good with time management. And so I would look at them and be like, you're going to die if you get into this. Because
a huge part, I think.
The guys who were running the theater program were looking at all of us saying, frankly, if you do try to pursue a creative field after university, you need to be working all the time. You need to be organizing your life and structuring your life. And every moment of your life is about accomplishing something, getting something done. Which is why I look so highly on someone like Lindsay Middleton, because she will sacrifice sleep in order to do that.
She'll just like be on 2 hours of sleep and bouncing around.
I can't.
Still be nice.
I know.
Which is so
it doesn't make
strange.
Sense. Yeah, she's on something.
I mean, I think she might be a robot. Let's just be honest.
I think she's on drugs.
A drugged robot.
A drugged robot.
We're on to you, Middleton.
but yeah, so you have to be prepared to be always striving every moment of every day, to be working towards your goals. So when you work your job to make your money, but once you've made your money, you go off and then do with your free time what you need to do.
Right. So how is the world of auditioning lately? Like, are you finding yourself going on a lot of auditions and then like, or not at all, and then being like, fuck this, I'm just going to create my own stuff? Like, mm-hmm. How is the, you know, auditioning going?
Well, I'm in kind of like a interesting place for that because I haven't been auditioning for about a year and a half, almost 2 years. I was with an agent who was great. I really enjoyed the relationship that we had.
My apartment now
looks like, you know, Call of Duty. It's completely blown to pieces.
You're hulking out here.
Hulking out. So I was with this agent, and then the agency was paring itself down. They invited me to stay, but I was going to try to look elsewhere, stupidly, without having a new agent. So I ended up I submitted to people who, they don't answer you. So then I just kind of gave up.
They really don't. They just don't answer.
They just don't answer.
And you're like, did this get to you? Did it get stuck in a weird box somewhere?
Yeah.
And then they're like, they just don't answer.
Yeah. So I kind of just decided, I'm like, okay, well, I guess I'm just not going to have an agent for a while. And that was a whatever. And I was just working my Joe jobs all the time and still doing stuff, like still doing Out With Dad, still doing Kate Conway as a Jerk. And then, of course, started dating an actor who auditioned all the time, and I started to miss it. So I promised myself that by the spring of 2016, I was going to get another agent. I was going to try again, and I did. And I've signed with this new agency, who I love. My agent, she's amazing.
Want to give a shout out
to Alicia Foucher at La Fever Talent. Yes,
that's a good one.
She's a good lady. She's really cool. So I've only been with her for about 2 months now, and she's really good because I will have been auditioning on average like once a week, whether it's for a commercial or for a TV show. Because I had been out of the game for a year and a half, she even looked at me and said, okay, so what rooms were you in? Do you remember the people that you saw? And I had to I told her about the TV shows that I auditioned for and sort of what I vaguely remembered. And so she made it a priority. She's like, okay, well, we're probably not going to book anything anytime soon, but we'll get you back in the room so they remember that you exist. And I was like, great. So what I'm doing now is mostly just reminding casting directors.
Interesting. That's an interesting strategy. That's cool.
So,
that makes sense. So that's worth something.
Exactly.
Because that's how they work, honestly. If there's just a face and a way that a person, you know, is like acting and they have it in their brain, then mm-hmm. it'll hopefully come up.
Yeah. I, fortunately enough, was able to, while I didn't have an agent though, my brother worked on the TV show Schitt's Creek.
Oh, nice.
And was able, he told me to contact the casting, Stephanie Gorin, I think it was. Mm-hmm. And I contacted her and she was like, oh yeah, I remember you, you know, from the handful of auditions you did back in the day. And then they did bring me in to read for a role on Schitt's Creek, but I didn't get it, but which was fine because I'm not even union, so.
Yeah, you just got to get in front of people at
exactly.
certain points. That's like a big part of the game.
And another piece of advice that I've talked with, Jason brought it to my attention because a colleague of ours who we both know, Ash Catherwood, wrote an article recently about why it's important to go union. And like a lot of people try to avoid it because they say, oh, once you go union, you stop working. It apparently took him about 2 years to actually get to the point where he was union and working fairly often. And which is, that makes sense. You do have to put in a lot of time going in over and over, reminding the casting directors, okay, yeah, this person's not right for this role, but I'll keep them in mind for the next time. So the fact that I did take a year and a half off from it, it does kind of hurt.
Yeah, it makes a dent.
It makes a dent, but it's, it was something that I needed to do because I was, balancing the Joe jobs with the acting, for me, I get so anxious about the thought of losing a Joe job.
Oh yeah.
I'm like, oh, I love
that. Well, because money, man.
You need, that's
like,
the thing.
You don't want to completely bottom out and be like, fuck, like I'm struggling. Mm-hmm. hard.
Exactly. So I just didn't, I'm always so nervous about losing my job jobs, but it's usually like, it's a fleeting feeling because then I'll just be back to my Star Trek, you know, seize the day mantra and be like, fuck it. If I lose my job, I'll just go get another job. Like it's not that big of a deal. So that's sort of the mentality that I'm approaching the auditions with now, and just making sure that I go to every single one and I'm giving 100% every time I go.
Mm-hmm.
So
how do you find, you did touch on like dating another actor, but I mean, like beyond that too, I'm sure you have lots of friends who are performers or getting different things. Like how is that sort of dealing with the competitive nature of that? Like being close to somebody who's also creating and getting maybe further than you might be. Like, mm-hmm. is there like a jealousy, or is there something that like it hurts you to see, like you're probably happy, but also sad that people are succeeding? Like it's kind of a weird thing because you want to do what they're doing.
Exactly.
So what's that like for you relationship wise, friends or like love, whatever?
I would say that like I secretly am incredibly jealous. But I'm good at hiding it.
Okay. Hey, that's honest. That's like an honest, more honest than most people.
Well, the thing I like about this podcast particularly that I think that you're trying to get at is you're trying to, for anybody listening who wants to be in the industry, sort mm-hmm. of like what are the ins and outs of
yeah.
it? What should you expect?
Yeah.
And frankly, if you are prone to jealousy, get ready because
yeah. hold on tight.
Yeah. And things, social media just makes it a million times worse because you might see someone on an audition
yeah.
at a callback, and then they'll post later on the day that they got the part, and you're like, oh great,
unfollow. No, unfollow. I don't want to know your things.
So it's something that like I know is stupid, and you want to be supportive of other people because other people really are supportive of you. They're mm-hmm. everyone's rooting for you as well. They want you to do well. They want you to be successful. So it can be tough. But it's something that I think most people would be lying if they said that they didn't feel a little bit of jealousy.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
But oftentimes
you got to deal with it inside though.
Yes.
Because it can get like really nasty and fester.
Well, it can add to those things, like I was saying earlier, that sort of like depression, that anxiety that sort of keeps you from doing anything
or enjoying life.
Yeah. You look at it and be like, why bother?
Yeah.
And that's a terrible way to look at it, but it's still a very human way to kind of react to it. So if you can just be conscious of the fact that your brain is thinking like this, but it's not healthy. Mm-hmm. You need to push forward, congratulate, like that goddamn post that
no matter
she
if you're gritting
got
your teeth.
That role on that crappy commercial that
you wanted. Not
gonna, yeah. then you'll be better for it, because when your time eventually does come, whatever successes you get, whether they be booking a commercial that you're going to make 10 grand from, or winning an award that no one's heard of, or finally doing the thing that you said you were going to do. You were going to make that web series. You were telling people and they didn't think it was going to happen, and then you did it. These are accomplishments that you will get to stand up and be proud of. You can't be winning awards nobody's heard of every day.
Yeah.
You've gotta.
And you can't be passive too. Like, mm-hmm. you know, I think there's a huge thing to be said for actually like that's what something I admire about you is that you complete things, which is sometimes creative people lack those things, which I get it. Like inspiration hits, you start something and then it's sort of like, yeah, well I lost interest, or like maybe funding didn't, or like a hiccup happened and you just didn't follow through.
Mm-hmm.
I think that you got to follow through. Like people follow through.
Like 90.
Even if it ends up being bad, even if it's a struggle.
99% of the success in this world is just people who stuck with it.
Absolutely.
Like, I look at somebody like Amy Schumer.
Mm-hmm.
And I go, if I had stuck with stand-up comedy, would I have had a career that was similar to hers?
Who knows? Possibly.
She was just somebody who just got up and did stand-up all the time.
Yeah.
She just, like, whether she sucked or whether it was great, she just did it the next day.
Yeah.
So if you can get up and do it the next day, then you're eventually going to get somewhere. It might not be exactly where you think you should be, or one of the big ones is where your parents or where your significant other or whoever
or
in your
friends
life.
Friends or whatever.
These expectations that other people have of you can really also get inside your head and make you think badly of yourself if you're not meeting them. If you just get up every day and do what you say you're going to do, you're eventually going to get somewhere. Mm-hmm. And it might be different than you expect, but it could be better than you expect.
Yeah, definitely. With that, is there any other advice that you'd give to somebody who's like either completely just like thinking like, I'm going to do a second city, like level A, or somebody who's young listening and wants to like go and do the theater program you did or something like that? Like, is there any other thing as well that you would suggest to people besides sort of like staying the course and like being real with themselves?
Well, just be prepared to work very hard and be ready for the rejection. Try to remind yourself, I knew people in theater school who put little mantras around their room. They wrote them on cue cards and just put them, like, posted them to their room.
Yep.
You know, if you need to make your Facebook profile picture a meme of, you know,
something that
failure is not falling down, it's staying down or something like that. you know, whatever it is, it's all about, it's fighting that thing in your mind that's telling you you can't do it, because really the only difference between success and failure is whether or not you decided to try again.
Yeah, you gotta keep doing that thing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so any other projects that are like happening for you? What's to come?
Well, other than the crowdsourcing thing for Kate Conway Is a Jerk that we're going to be hopefully putting out shortly, I've been involved with an online sketch thing. I don't even know what I would call it, with some people from Second City,
mm-hmm.
And it's called Tennyson Industries.
Okay,
there's going to be a Facebook page that you can like, and we're going to be posting videos in the near future that I've written and have been in. So it's going to be really funny. We just wanted to be really successful and make $1 million. So get on that,
right,
everyone
on.
Else.
I will be able to post all of those links. So if you guys check out the show notes on fakingitpodcast.com, you'll see Kate's episode notes and all of those things I will have.
Cool.
And keep an eye out for hashtag Kate Conway Is a Jerk.
Yes.
Season 2. Thank you for coming on.
Thanks.
See ya.
Bye.
Bye. Thanks for listening, everyone, and thanks to Kate for coming on the show. Check out www.fakingitpodcast.com for the show notes. You'll find all the links mentioned today there, as well as our blog guest series, which is really fun and cool to check out. Follow on Facebook and Instagram and Twitter at Faking It Podcast. Thanks, and until next time.